hour will be on infectious diseases of marine mammals, and I'll just cover what I can cover in that period of time. Many of you may be wondering what the AFIP has to do with marine mammals. Actually, we have a rather long history of being involved in marine mammal work. The U.S. Navy has studied, trained, and utilized cetaceans, mainly bottlenose dolphins, also some beluga whales, and California sea lions for about 30 years. So we've supported their program during all of that period. Dr. George Magaki was at the AFIP for many years until retiring just recently. And Dr. Magaki had a strong personal interest in diseases of marine mammals, and he brought many cases to the AFIP. In recent years, we've gotten involved as in the sea otter work at the request of the Fish and Wildlife Service, and in studying dolphin mortality at the request of the National Marine Fisheries Service. One of the problems in study of these free-living marine mammals is that the collections of pathological material tend to be small and widely scattered throughout the country, indeed throughout the world. One thing that we're trying to do as a partial solution to that problem is to establish a formal registry of marine mammal pathology at the AFIP. We already have well over 2,000 cases from our previous work to start to build on. One thing that I always emphasize when I make the little pitch for people sending us free living marine mammal cases is by all means, continue to use the pathologist that you're currently using, or if you're a pathologist, we're not asking you to stop doing what you're doing. We would just appreciate it if you would send us a duplicate set of specimens. Okay, I had a few sentences that I was going to say on justifying the study of infectious diseases of these animals, but after Dr. Nielsen so eloquently covered that subject last night, I think I'll just move on. Before I get started, I do want to acknowledge several people who have contributed material that I'll be showing you. They include Drs. Magaki, Moeller, Medway, Domingo, Kennedy, Wilson, Barr, and I think I've got some of Jim Britt's slides who's sitting right there. Okay. When we talk about marine mammals, we're basically addressing ourselves to four or five different groups of mammals. Included are the odontocetes, or toothed whales, exemplified here by bottlenose dolphins. The other cetacean group is the mysticetes, or the baleen whales. Pinnipeds are also considered in the group. These are stellar sea lions in Alaska. These are otered seals, phocid seals, walruses are in their own group. Sea otters, certainly. The sirenians are also included. Don't have any pictures of sirenians, but the manatees and dugongs. And some people include polar bears as marine mammals. But my presentation today is going to be focused primarily on small cetaceans, pinnipeds, with a little on sea otters and manatees. We'll start with viral diseases, which have been the most exciting area in marine mammal disease research recently. In the last few years, morbilliviruses have emerged as causes of major epizootics that have affected marine mammal species at the population level in a number of locations. In 1987, a morbillivirus closely related to canine distemper virus caused the deaths of thousands of Baikal seals in Lake Baikal in the former Soviet Union. An outbreak of a different strain of morbillivirus killed approximately 17,000 harbor seals in the northwestern Europe in 1988. Another morbillivirus outbreak killed thousands of striped dolphins in the Mediterranean Sea in 1990 and 1991. Fatal morbillivirus infection has also been reported recently in harbor porpoises and a single common dolphin. Very recently, my colleagues and I have documented morbilliviral disease in Atlantic bottlenose dolphins, both on the Atlantic coast and in the Gulf of Mexico. We really shouldn't be too surprised that morbilliviruses have caused major epizootics in marine mammals. Morbilliviruses have demonstrated their ability to cause large-scale epizootics many times in many species. Certainly, rinderpest epizootics have swept across Africa. When canine distemper virus first entered Europe a couple of hundred years ago, a large proportion of the dogs in Europe died. When the European explorers visited the New World, they brought human morbillivirus, or measles, with them. And the combination of measles and smallpox frequently killed from a half to two-thirds of native populations who had not previously been exposed. Start with the harbor seal morbillivirus. The affected harbor seals were dyspneic and had serous to mucopurulent oculonasal discharges. The lungs of these animals had patchy, or as in this case, cranioventral consolidation. Interstitial emphysema, seen here, was also quite common. The emphysema frequently extended through fascial planes into the subcutaneous tissues of the neck. Histologically, there was a bronchointerstitial pneumonia. Frequently, there was a suppurative bronchopneumonia as well, which was probably caused by secondary bacterial infections. Now, I'm having a hard time seeing inclusion bodies from here, but there were occasional intracytoplasmic inclusion bodies in airway epithelium. Can anybody pick it out? Well, we can all see that in any case. Syncytial cells were also an occasional finding. This is an immunoperoxidase stain demonstrating morbillivirus antigen within the bronchiolar epithelium. The only clinical sign that was observed in affected striped dolphins was disorientation. They would occasionally crash into boats. Generally, they were found moribund or dead on the beach. Similar to the harbor seal epizootic, pneumonia was the primary gross finding. This lung has, again, cranioventral consolidation and atelectasis. Just a closer view of the atelectatic areas that are dark red. Histologically, there was a necrotizing bronchointerstitial pneumonia. You can see there's an abundant cellular debris within the alveoli. Again, you can see the abundant debris. Syncytial cells are also quite common, in some cases at least. Sometimes the syncytia remain attached to the wall of the airway. Often they're free in the lumen, or the alveoli, I should say. This thin section demonstrates the syncytial cells with intranuclear inclusion bodies very nicely. And again, immunoperoxidase staining demonstrates morbillivirus antigen within syncytial cells, type 2 pneumocytes, macrophages. And just one more example, again, showing the viral antigen within syncytial cells. Encephalitis was also a common finding, non-suppurative encephalitis. Again, syncytial cells were sometimes found in association with the encephalitis. There's a nice intranuclear inclusion body in that cell. Lymphoid organs often showed a dramatic depletion of lymphocytes. This is spleen from an affected striped dolphin, and all of the white pulp areas, as you can see, are very pale, whereas they should be dark blue from numerous lymphocytes. And at higher magnification, again, you can see the paucity of lymphocytes, and syncytial cells are sometimes found within these depleted white pulp areas. Harbor porpoises also were found to be affected by a morbillivirus in recent years. This has only affected relatively small numbers of harbor porpoises. There has not been a recognized epizootic. Affected animals have been found on the coast of Northern Ireland and England. Lesions were generally similar to those seen in the harbor porpoise and the striped dolphins. The harbor seals, rather, and the striped dolphins. The harbor porpoises tended to have some rather ill-defined intracytoplasmic inclusions in neurons. A single common dolphin has been reported to have had lesions, histologic lesions, compatible with morbillivirus infection, consisting of pulmonary syncytia and lymph node syncytia. But immunoperoxidase studies or other forms of confirmation were not reported. The new information that I have for you relates to the morbillivirus that has recently been detected in bottlenose dolphins. Just about a year ago, in June of 93, a bottlenose dolphin stranded near Panama City, Florida, and Byron Ford, who's a veterinarian at Gulf World Aquarium in Panama City, performed a necropsy. Byron is a member of the Marine Mammal Stranding Network, which is a volunteer organization that works closely with the National Marine Fisheries Service to assist and study stranded marine mammals. Byron sent material from this dolphin to me, and this is trachea from this dolphin. The mucosa has undergone coagulative necrosis, and you can see that there are branching fungal hyphae present throughout this zone, and a suppurative inflammatory reaction in the deeper tissue. Higher magnification. Try to focus that a little. The hyphae are septate. They branch at acute angles. They're about 3 to 6 microns in diameter, so they're morphologically compatible with Aspergillus species. This is lung from the dolphin, showing a radial array of fungal hyphae characteristic of aspergillosis. The fungus was also present in the myocardium, so the cause of death was likely disseminated aspergillosis. However, within the lungs, there were also occasional multinucleated cells, as seen here. And infrequently, intranuclear inclusion bodies could be seen within these syncytial cells. And the syncytial cell really has a very characteristic morphology. Morbillivirus-induced syncytia don't always have this morphology, but when they do, it's distinctive. And that you have this ring of nuclei surrounding a central zone of eosinophilia. Then there's a more peripheral zone of clear cytoplasm, and the cell margin is out here. So, having seen that cell and a few others like it, I was very suspicious that this dolphin did have morbillivirus infection. So I sent sections to Dr. Seamus Kennedy in Northern Ireland. Dr. Kennedy has done a lot of work with marine mammal morbillivirus outbreaks, including the harbor seal outbreak, harbor porpoises, and striped dolphins. And he has this immunoperoxidase, which I've already showed you some examples of. And the immunoperoxidase is it's raised against a hemagglutinin protein of focine distemper virus. It's intended to be an indicator of morbillivirus infections in general, but it's not specific as to strain. It works well on canine distemper, human measles, and all of the marine mammal morbilliviruses. So there's staining of an intranuclear inclusion body in this syncytial cell and abundant intracytoplasmic antigen. There also is a degree of background staining. This is just oral epithelium from this dolphin, again, demonstrating morbillivirus antigen. So that case was the first documented case of morbillivirus infection in an animal in the a marine mammal in the Gulf of Mexico. We quickly checked to see if there was any increase in the stranding rate at that time in Florida, and there was not. So we were unsure what was going on. If we didn't know if the virus was perhaps enzootic, and this was just a sporadic case, or if we were early in an epizootic, we just didn't know. But later in the summer, we received additional cases, five cases from Alabama, clustered around Mobile Bay, one case from a barrier island off the coast of Mississippi. And these were in August, September, October, November, that time frame. And at those times and in those states, there was increased stranding. Stranding rate was not dramatically increased, but for example, 1 month it was, I believe, 11 in Alabama, whereas the historical mean is more like 2 for that particular month. So it was an increase, but nothing too dramatic. This is another affected dolphin. Again, there was pulmonary aspergillosis. In this case, there was also bacterial pneumonia, gram-negative bacterial pneumonia. Interestingly, of the 7 morbillivirus-infected animals from the Gulf, 5 had aspergillosis. Here's just an airway from this dolphin with an intranuclear inclusion body. The inclusions are rare and difficult to find. The syncytial cells are frequently rare, but we had one case, this one here, that had, well, it varied regionally. There are lung sections where there are none, but there are also lung sections where there are numerous, very large, prominent syncytial cells. And here's another one with that characteristic morphology that I mentioned with the central eosinophilia peripheral clearing. This is epidermis from an affected dolphin with a rather ill-defined syncytial cell with intranuclear inclusion bodies. Lymph node, the small syncytial cell, kind of mild lymphoid depletion. And sort of a classic canine distemper lesion, urinary bladder with intracytoplasmic inclusion bodies in many cells. You don't need to really look at these closely. These are just to remind me that there was increased stranding in Alabama and in Mississippi that coincided with stranding of morbillivirus-infected dolphins. Many of the dolphins that stranded were in poor condition or were not necropsied, so we don't know how many were infected by morbillivirus, but there's a circumstantial association. Then the stranding rates returned to pretty much normal in Alabama and Mississippi toward the end of 93. But in Texas, things started getting interesting. You can see in December, the 15 dolphins stranded with a historical mean of about 6. And the stranding rate was remained up in January. Since I made this slide, it's continued to rise. In the first 3 months of 1994, well over 200 dolphins had stranded on the Texas coast, and that's as compared with a normal annual total of around 60. So there's definitely something going on in the dolphins off the Texas coast. Unfortunately, all of these animals have been in extremely poor condition when they've been found. They've had advanced post-mortem decomposition. But back last summer, after we had the first case, I met with some people in the molecular diagnostics laboratory of the AFIP and asked them if they might be able to develop a sensitive test for the virus. And they were interested, said they thought they ought to be able to develop a polymerase chain reaction test. So that said, that sounds great. I would call them every month or so and ask how it was going. And they said, oh, I'm having problems, not easy. So I quit calling and had pretty much given up. But then just about a month ago, they called me up and they said, well, we've got the test working. And it's, I don't know how many of you are familiar with the polymerase chain reaction technology, but it's truly revolutionary. The technique can identify, can detect and specifically identify very minute amounts of DNA or RNA, specific segments of DNA or RNA, then amplify those segments. In other words, make many, many copies on the order of hundreds of thousands to millions to a billion copies of the genetic material in question. Then when you have that sort of a quantity, the DNA or RNA can be detected by banding in a gel column. And the PCR product, this amplified product, can also be subjected to genetic probes to identify specific sequences. So the way they designed this polymerase chain reaction was the initial PCR was directed towards a segment of the genome that's common to morbilliviruses. So it was a general morbillivirus detection. Then the PCR product can be examined with probes to determine the strain of morbillivirus. And it's just a complete departure from the way things had to be done in the past. For example, they developed these tests without having any morbillivirus. What they had was a publication of genetic sequences from morbilliviruses. So you just look at the genetic code as it's written there and design your test. The only thing you need positives and negatives for are testing it. So that was my big part in all this. I provided them with some good positives where we had characteristic lesions and they were immunoperoxidase positive. Good negatives, dolphins from the West Coast with no evidence of morbillivirus infection, neonatal dolphins, things like that. And I also provided them with some cases in which we strongly suspected morbillivirus because of the presence of characteristic lesions like syncytia, but the immunoperoxidase had been negative. And it correctly identified the known positives, the known negatives, and found the ones that had been immunoperoxidase negative, but we suspected them to be positive, as positive. So that's as it should be. It should be much more sensitive than an immunoperoxidase. And this is all on paraffin-embedded formalin-fixed material. Truly amazing. So having digested the information that they could actually do this, I got in touch with the National Marine Fisheries Service and asked them to send me whatever material had been collected from these dolphins, regardless of the state of postmortem decomposition. I figured it was worth a try. So I got this cooler in the mail, one of these about, 50-gallon plastic coolers. And there were specimens, 57 specimens in there, and like three or four bags of that blue ice. So they had been frozen in Texas, and they put them in here, and they threw in this blue ice and FedExed it to Washington. So needless to say, many of the samples had thawed, stunk to high heaven. So with some reluctance, the molecular diagnostics people have started looking at it. And we only have results on the first batch of five, but three had morbillivirus in lung. So I don't know, I still can hardly believe it, that a virus can be identified in material that's that poor, that specifically identified, but that's what they did. And it's apparent that the bottlenose dolphin virus, not unexpectedly, is very closely related to the striped dolphin virus. Oops. So I guess you could, I wouldn't go too far with three out of five, but if that sort of a proportion holds up, I think we would have some pretty good evidence that morbillivirus is probably the cause of the Texas mortality as well, particularly given the fact that we have conclusive diagnosis on including histopathology and immunoperoxidase on several dolphins in adjacent states, the timing of the event coming immediately after finding those dolphins. So now I would like to, for a few minutes, digress from very current and ongoing studies to some retrospective work that we've done. I'm sure many of you remember the 1987-88 East Coast bottlenose dolphin epizootic. It began in June of that year in New Jersey, spread south, eventually reaching Florida, went on for about 11 months, 742 dolphin carcasses were collected, so that many were known to have been killed, and the estimates are that about half of the inshore population of bottlenose dolphins in the affected area died. Streptococcus came from, but this is right. The National Marine Fisheries Service eventually organized an investigation to determine the cause of the epizootic, and Dr. Joseph Gerasi of the Ontario Veterinary College was the leader of the investigation. It was an extremely formidable task. The carcasses extended over this large geographic range. As always, many of them were in poor state of preservation. This was a very hot topic in the media, lots of media attention, lots of pressure to identify the cause as rapidly as possible. Dr. Gerasi concluded that brevetoxin was the cause of the event. Brevetoxin is a neurotoxin produced by algae, red tides. The fundamental basis for that determination was the detection of brevetoxin in 7 of 18 dolphin livers. Basically, Dr. Gerasi hypothesized that the dolphins consumed fish that had been contaminated with the brevetoxin. The dolphins became ill and were stressed by intoxication. They ate less, mobilized fat, which might have released other stored contaminants. Dolphins frequently have high levels of PCBs and other contaminants within their blubber, so that might then have had an additional impact on the dolphins. And eventually the dolphins succumbed to opportunistic infections. The main pathological findings were cutaneous and oral ulcers, bacterial and fungal pneumonias, and bacterial septicemias, and there was a variety of types of bacteria involved. This conclusion, this hypothesis, was very controversial. So controversial, in fact, that congressional subcommittee hearings were held on the investigation. And during these hearings, a number of scientists gave testimony that found fault with the brevetoxin theory. Some of these problems are listed here. There was a red tide off of Cape Hatteras in October of 87. However, the mortality began in New Jersey in June, and there was no red tide apparent at that time. Red tides normally cause mortality of a variety of species, fish, shellfish, birds, and only in the vicinity of Cape Hatteras was that the case. Elsewhere, it was quite species-specific, affecting bottlenose dolphins. Brevetoxin has not been previously reported to affect dolphins, and red tides are not rare in areas where dolphins are numerous. Brevetoxin is also, as I mentioned, an acute neurotoxin, tends to cause death by respiratory paralysis. It's not known to be immunosuppressive or to produce the lesions that were found in the dolphins. Then more recently, the assay method that was used at the University of Miami to detect the brevetoxin in the dolphin livers was subjected to a test, and it was found to have a high incidence of both false positives and false negatives, and it was concluded that the test is not at a reliable stage of development. There have been other proposed etiologies. As I mentioned, PCBs and other chlorinated hydrocarbon toxins were found at relatively high levels in many of these dolphins. However, those levels are generally comparable to those that can be found in both captive and free-living bottlenose dolphins that appear to be healthy. Just coming up with amounts of contaminants in animals without a correlation to lesions or functional or biochemical abnormalities is not very helpful. All you can really say is that they had high levels of these materials. The weather was quite unusual. The summer of 87, there were apparently Gulf Stream eddies tended to hold water close to shore along the Atlantic coast, and there were garbage slicks and medical waste washing up at that time. And some people proposed that perhaps there was bacterial overgrowth in these waters, and the dolphins, because of the volume of the inoculum, if you will, became infected by the bacteria. This idea fails to account for the geographic expanse of the die-off. The final proposed etiology was viral infection. Dr. Gerasi considered viral infection, but eventually dismissed it. Their cultures were negative. Dr. Gerasi is not a pathologist, but the pathologist who examined the material did not find evidence of viral infection. Electron microscopic studies were done, and they found no evidence of viral infection. However, my colleague and wife, Yvonne Shulman, and I began looking at this material some months ago now, and actually before looking at the histologic sections, just reading the data on the die-off suggested to us that it was an infectious agent because it began in one place, New Jersey. It spread geographically over time. It caused species-specific mortality. And the reported lesions were suggestive of immunosuppression, and there are certain viruses that are immunosuppressive. So we've completed an initial study that was limited to lungs and lymph nodes of 79 dolphins. And we certainly confirmed the prevalence of fulminant bacterial and fungal pneumonias, evidence of bacterial septicemia, but we also found multinucleated cells in the lung that we suspected were viral syncytia. But it was often a very difficult interpretation to make because you did have these other infectious agents present. Many of the dolphins have lung worms that can cause a granulomatous reaction. So it's very difficult to be certain that a multinucleated cell is a viral-induced syncytial cell versus a inflammatory giant cell in some cases. But the lesions that we found that convinced us that we had a viral infection were those in the lymph nodes. This is a lymph node, and you can see that there's a rather marked depletion. Oops. And there are multinucleated cells within the lymph node, This is a depleted germinal center. It was quite common to find these multinucleated cells with this more stellate or elongate morphology associated with the depleted germinal centers. I think these are macrophages. And occasionally you'd find a more distinctive viral inclusion, or syncytial cell rather. And we also found syncytial cells undergoing necrosis, which we considered highly suggestive of a viral infection. So again, we've collaborated with Dr. Kennedy in Ireland, and at this point we've demonstrated morbillivirus antigen in 53% of the dolphins tested. And there's also a correlation between the presence of morbillivirus antigen and the presence of other infections, bacterial, fungal, and so forth, consistent with morbillivirus-mediated immunosuppression, as occurs in canine distemper and measles in people, and a variety of morbillivirus-induced diseases. So we believe that we have strong evidence that morbillivirus infection was the cause of the 87-88 mortality event. There have been some interesting antigenic and genetic comparative studies of the marine mammal morbilliviruses. I mentioned the Lake Baikal epizootic in 1987. The morbillivirus that caused that event is either extremely closely related or identical to canine distemper virus. So it's likely that those seals were infected by either a canine distemper infected dog or some other terrestrial carnivore. The harbor seal virus is more closely related to canine distemper virus than the other morbilliviruses, but it's definitely a distinct morbillivirus. The striped dolphin and the harbor porpoise morbilliviruses are closely related to each other, and they are more closely related to rinderpest virus than to canine distemper virus. The just preliminary hint that we have on the bottlenose dolphin virus is that it's probably very closely related to the striped dolphin virus. The fascinating question to me about all this is why has there been this clustering in time of four, or if you include the Gulf of Mexico, five major morbillivirus epizootics in marine mammals, excluding the Gulf. That's four of those events in a four-year period. Some people have tried to suggest that pollution might be the cause, but I find it difficult to believe that pollution, I mean, the PCBs, for example, that are immunosuppressive in other species, but it's hard to believe that pollution reached a critical immunosuppressive level in Lake Baikal, northwestern Europe, the east coast of the United States, and the Gulf of Mexico within this period of time. And there's no evidence that something like that occurred. In fact, in several of those areas, the pollution is in fact better than it has been previously. So that doesn't seem likely. At first thought, a virus, a labile virus, infecting species, moving from one species to the next, sounds very attractive. Unfortunately, the virologists say that these different morbilliviruses are separated Well, for example, the seal viruses and the cetacean viruses are separated from each other by substantial evolution, probably at least hundreds of years. So the only hypothesis that I would throw out, again, I'm definitely speculating, but one thing that has been found is that antibodies to morbilliviruses have been demonstrated in seals from Greenland and Canada prior to the harbor seal epizootic. So that has caused speculation that there might be morbilliviruses in zootic in those species. They came into contact with a closely related species, the harbor seal, and the harbor seals had no prior immunity, so it caused an epizootic. One could make similar speculations regarding the cetacean morbilliviruses. Some of these populations have been large and expanding, creating a situation where you could have species coming into contact with one another that where they haven't done that in the recent past. But in my mind, that's the best hypothesis or the most reasonable one I've heard so far. But still, it's remarkable that so many epizootics are clustered so tightly in time. I think I might as well just stop there. Are there any questions or comments? Yes.
In regards to your last comment, I was recently over a meeting in Europe, Osterhaus, and some of the people from Great Britain. And I think Osterhaus presented some of this data at the marine mammal meeting last year. But being a virologist, he likes the concept that morbilliviruses are immunosuppressive, but they've gone back and they've taken two populations of harbor seals. They've got 11 animals in each group. They are vaccinated against morbilliviruses. Half of them have been feeding fish from the Baltic Ocean, which is heavily contaminated. The other half, they've been feeding fish from the North Atlantic, which is relatively, shall we say, more pristine. And what they're finding, they've just been doing some basic immunological parameters, and Osterhaus really didn't expect to see any difference between the two groups of seals. But within 6 weeks of being on these diets, they started to see a decline in natural killer cell activity in the seals being fed fish from the Baltic. Also, their lymphoproliferative assays are starting to diminish, both to mitogen and antigen-specific responses, whereas their humoral immunity was unimpaired. These studies have been going on for 2 years now, and some mediated immunity has really fallen off on these seals that have been fed fish from the Baltic. They're now getting ready to switch. I think they've actually have switched, and they're switching the two groups to see if those animals which have been fed the heavily contaminated fish will resume normal cell-mediated immunity, and those that have been fed the other diet will start to show a depression in cell-mediated immunity. So Albert kind of doesn't like to think about this, but there may be many multi-factors going on to precipitate these epizootics. And I thought it was interesting. I had forgotten during the die-off of cetaceans in 87 and 88, you had disturbances in the Gulf Stream. Mm-hmm. Die-off in the North Atlantic with the harbor seals was an unusual year, and that the seals were having to swim farther out to get fish. There was a severe depletion in their food sources there. So there were changes going on there,
right,
that contributed to mobilization of these accumulated contaminants. I mean, you can start to put together a whole scenario of things that could be going on, and I think you're also right. Some of these animals, particularly the ones in the North Atlantic, they did not have any historical evidence that they had seen morbilliviruses before. And of course, one of the things that concerns people in the Mediterranean is that the Mediterranean monk seals also, they haven't seen
right.
that many, but they're also seronegative for morbilliviruses. And what would happen if morbilliviruses was introduced into this population?
And they're severely endangered.
Very endangered. Though right now man seems to be their biggest problem and not viruses, but.
Right. It's the impact of pollution on all this. It really is difficult to put your finger on. mean, certainly no one can say that contaminants weren't involved in some way, because the contaminants are in the animals, that's for sure.
Okay.